4-1 to drive performance improvement. Plus, with the head of the enterprise stewardship, it sounds like professional staff and management and R&D, ESS, regulatory affairs, supply chain, and other business functions. But to have the best chance for success, the initiative needs to be championed by a group of the senior executive. Although this could certainly be said for most major business initiatives, it's especially true for product stewardship. Only a senior executive sponsor is going to be able to drive the degree of cross-functional collaboration needed, as well as the extensive coordination with supply chain partners, including IT systems integration. And as with other sustainability initiatives, there could be a significant amount of culture change involved, and senior leadership, involvement, and direct participation is going to be needed to make it stick. The next recommendation is to improve collaboration with suppliers. Close supplier collaboration is needed to get disclosure of sustainability data, including materials, substances, conflict minerals, environmental performance, and social compliance. Based on your supplier code of conduct, suppliers need to be held accountable for meeting KPIs, such as on-time disclosure and providing the necessary evidence of compliance. Really, suppliers should be as engaged with product stewardship mandates as those within your own organization. Accomplishing this is really dependent on having an effective communications program with a blend of both incentivizing and encouraging suppliers to disclose and validate the right materials and substance information at the right time, as well as smelter information and other environmental and social compliance information. And a key aspect of supplier collaboration is to automate and streamline information exchange by integrating suppliers with enterprise systems, especially those managing product-related data and business processes. And the fifth recommendation is to adopt one integrated product lifecycle management system. Manufacturers can really optimize product stewardship by having a centralized, consolidated product lifecycle management system. An integrated PLM system enables effective and efficient management of the complete lifecycle from concept to design, to sourcing and manufacturing, to distribution and sales, to service and eventual disposal. This approach supports the necessary collaboration and provides one system of record so that accurate, timely information is available when and where needed. A unified PLM system also helps embed sustainability requirements into the full product lifecycle, including material disclosures, substance compliance, and environmental and social compliance reporting. So in conclusion, with more regulations and increasing stakeholder demands, price stewardship is coming to the forefront as a key business issue for manufacturers, as a key pillar for a sustainable business. Along with the right people and processes, the right technology strategy is needed to support complex information management requirements, not just within the enterprise, but across the extended supply chain. Today, many businesses are still trying to get by with siloed legacy systems that drive up costs and introduce risk into the product lifecycle. Manufacturers now have an opportunity to use product stewardship as a source of competitive advantage, but this will depend on taking a holistic approach of having the right people and processes supported by modern information technology. Thank you for joining the presentation today, and that concludes the presentation.
Keen Center provides you with an easy way to add a new group of employees to your organization through the use of wizards in the organization application. For example, the ADC company has hired a product validation manager for a new group called Product Validation, which is being established to ensure product quality. By using a single seamless process, you can create group and role definitions, the user definition, and the person definition. To begin, first select groups from the organization list tree. Now in the name box of the groups pane, type Product Validation. Notice the red asterisk. This indicates required information. In the description box, type this is the new Product Validation group. For this example, for security level, select internal. For the default volume, select volume 1. Now click create. Select the new product validation group from the organization tree. Notice the 5 buttons at the bottom of the definition pane. Click add role. In the organization role wizard, select add new role to the group. And then click next. To provide a name for the new role, type product validation manager. Although the description box is optional, for future reference, type this is a new role for the new product validation group. To create the new role, click finish. To add a new user to the role, select add a user to product validation manager. Then click next. Select add new user to the group, role. Then click next. In the person name box, type a name for the user. In the user ID box, type an ID for the user. In the OS name box, type the operating system name of the user. And finally, in the password box, type the password for the user. Click finish. You have now created the group, the role, and the user. Click close. Note the product validation manager role and the new user have been created within the new product validation group.
Let's explore the business modeler IDE user interface. Let's start by looking at EOS. The BMIDE assistant view helps you get started using the business modeler IDE. Choose topics in the assistant to learn how to perform common tasks. If you want to learn more about the task in the assistant, click the read more link. The help view shows online help for the business modeler IDE. You can read an individual help page or browse all pages. To make more room on the workspace, you can close views. If you want to open views later, you can choose window. Then show view. You can even change the view size by dragging the edge of the view. The main view that you will use is the BMIDE view. This view shows elements that model business data. The business objects folder contains elements that represent the most commonly used objects, such as items and datasets. The extensions folder contains a variety of extension elements. The project files folder contains the files managed by the project. You can add model elements to the favorites folder by right-clicking an element and choosing add to favorites. You can also filter out which elements are visible in the user interface by right-clicking an element and choosing filter. Let's take a closer look at the business objects folder. In this folder, you can browse the business objects. Or you can click the find button to look for objects. For example, you can search for the item business object. Now you can click the properties tab to see the properties on the business object. You can even add new properties to the business object. Now that we've explored views on business objects, let's look at your project files. Close the business objects folder and open the project files folder. The project files folder contains all the custom data model objects you create for Team Center. The default file in the extensions folder contains the custom data model definitions. The output folder contains files generated when you deploy your project to a server or package your project into a template. Now let's look at the project properties. Let's click the project and choose properties from the context menu. Selecting Center. Then BMIDE. Here you can see all the project properties, including the templates used for the project. Anytime you need help, choose help on the menu bar. And then choose help contents. In the help window, choose the business modeler ID guide. Then select the topic you want to read. Now that you have seen an overview of the user interface, watch other videos to learn how to create custom data model definitions using the business modeler IDE.
Team Center Rapid Start is a complete, easy to use, and easy to install product data management solution. Rapid Start is designed to optimize time to value for small to mid-sized manufacturing companies, departmental work groups, suppliers to OEMs, and other product manufacturers. From initial ideas to requirements, to design, approval, and manufacturing, Rapid Start is lab neutral and supports industry standard PDM best practices. Pre-configured groups, with roles for authors and consumers, workflows, and other features, support your business process in an extensible environment. Your information technology, engineering, management, and manufacturing groups can all use these features to work with product data and align with your business process. The Rapid Start business process includes managing CAD data, documents, and processes, supported by role-based secure data, visualization, and platform deployment. Rapid Start supports IT, design, manufacturing, and management in the business process. For the IT group, software installation is streamlined, users are easily assigned to groups and roles, clients are deployed, and intelligent part numbering can be configured. Access control lists secure your data and let users interact with data based on group and role. The engineering group creates and documents parts and assemblies. You can use intelligent part numbering and best practice workflows, or for users create objects and submit them to best practice workflow processes. Status values are assigned by these processes. During design and review phases, you can use Express Review to share data with people who do not have Team Center Rapid Start. Create a review package, then send the review package for external review. When the review package is returned, then put it back into Rapid Start. Managers, included in reviews, can contribute to product design and documentation within workflows or as needed. The manufacturing group designers, checkers, and managers use the engineering order object to specify parts and assemblies to be revised. The engineering order workflow lets you initiate change requests and changes in documents. The shop floor consumer group participates in the business process by using the shop floor viewer. The shop floor viewer is a pre-configured thin client you can access using a web browser. You can quickly find released parts and documentation on the shop floor. The Rapid Start business process supports information technology, engineering, management, and manufacturing. It also supports multi-CAD environments and intelligent part numbering. A pre-configured organization is provided, along with best practice document management, workflows, secure data access and sharing, visualization, and platform deployment. Team Center Rapid Start is a complete solution for product manufacturers.
Fourth generation design, or 4GD, responds to four critical business challenges in the shipbuilding industry. Potentially millions of instances of parts that require discrete management, a fast search engine, and high-performance visualization capabilities. Multiple perspectives of product content. System-driven product development. And optimization of the engineering process to allow designers to work only with the information needed for the task. The shipbuilding industry requires a highly scalable product design environment that supports millions of objects. The products produced are extremely complex with a very high part of instance count. The traditional BOM structure does not support the complexity of the product. There is an inherent need for multiple views of program content during the design process, due to the following considerations: the phase of the design process, an individual's role, the design task, and the required product perspective. For example, functional, spatial, and physical schemes need to support system-driven product development within a collaborative design environment, and without affecting the definitions of the design. Support for collaborative design improves user and team productivity by providing a flexible concurrent working environment. Design elements form the product designs. Partitions separate design elements into functional, physical, or spatial-based groupings. Subsets define the search rules and recipes to collect design elements. The subsets are usable and shared among designers. Worksets create a space for collected design elements. In worksets, users perform design tasks relative to the collected design elements and can reference design elements from other programs. For example, within the generator room partition, a workset identifies the piping in a subset of the partition. In the workset, an engineer can analyze a new path for the piping through the engine room. Also, 4GD facilitates the creation of associations between objects and processes, such as each unique part in a shift structure. Our 4GD solution supports a concurrent working environment, an organized hierarchy of the product to allow for different views on the product and to allow for rapid search and data display, options to choose the view that best fits the working environment. All of these solutions help to optimize the various engineering processes. Fourth generation design is the solution for the shipbuilding challenges of today.
Using the Team Center Substance Compliance Solution, you as the compliance officer can check whether a part or lot in the Team Center database complies with regulation directives. Regulations such as REACH, ROSE, and Conflict Minerals address the user specified substances and provide some exemptions based on how parts are used. This video will show you how you can determine if a lamp supplied by Auto Parts Supply Limited used in the headlamp assembly of your car is compliant with REACH. As the lamp is a vendor part, you do not know the materials and substances it comprises of. Therefore, you must request the vendor to declare the materials and substances used in the lamp. You start using similar workflow, in which a form called the Material Substance Declaration or MSD is sent to the vendor via email in the IPC1752XML format. After entering the information in the MSD, the vendor sends it to you via email. You then import the MSD using the Substance Compliance Support MSD utility. The MSD is now available on your worklist for review. While reviewing the MSD, you note that one of the materials used in the lamp is glass bottle. It is made of mercury, phosphor, and silica. However, the vendor has not entered the chemical abstract surface, or CAS, the mass, and the unit of measure, UOM, of the substances. Therefore, you reject the MSD and an email is sent to the vendor, mentioning the reason for the rejection. The vendor enters the missing information and presents the MSD to you. Once again, you import the MSD into Team Center. You review the MSD in your worklist and note that the information related to the glass bottle is complete. You approve the MSD and an email is sent to the vendor, mentioning that it is approved. Also, the MSD and the materials are assigned to the lamp. The lamp is now ready for a substance compliance check. You start a substance compliance check to verify if the lamp conforms to the REACH regulation. The results show the status of the lamp is under proof fail. This is because as per REACH, nickel is a restricted substance. However, REACH has an exemption that allows nickel to be used if it is not in direct and prolonged contact with the skin. As the nickel used in the lamp is not in direct contact with skin, you apply the exception and change the substance compliance status of the lamp to approved pass. The lamp can now be used in REACH compliance products designed at Team Center. To summarize, the Team Center Substance Compliance Solution is an environmental compliance solution that enables companies to conform to environmental laws, regulations, standards, and other requirements for their own parts and for the parts manufactured or supplied from an external source.
Team Center preferences control application behavior by letting you modify the interface, set default behavior, and specify default values, among other things. This video provides information about Team Center preferences and provides a tour of the risk client options dialog box, a common way to work with preferences. Administrators set preferences for the site, such as whether to use a standard calendar or a 24-hour calendar. Users set many preferences for themselves, such as how many objects to load immediately during a search. Team Center has system preferences and hierarchical preferences. System preference values apply to the entire site. Hierarchical preference values apply based on protection scopes such as site, group, role, and user. These protection scopes indicate who can create an instance of a preference. The protection scope also determines where in the database the preference values are stored. The preference definition includes information such as the name, protection scope, and description. Preference instances specify the value for a given preference for the site, group, role, and user. Only administrators can create or modify preference definitions. This includes changing the protection scope of any hierarchical preference. Preferences provided with Team Center cannot be deleted. Set preferences using the risk client. From the edit menu, choose options. This displays the options dialog box. Click the links at the bottom of the dialog box to display different panes. Options. Filters. Search. And organization. The options pane provides a subset of preferences in which you can find and set many preferences by using the list on the left side. This provides a user-friendly way to enter preference values by using value lists and checkboxes. Users can set preference values without having to know the preference name. For example, you can specify whether to remove files at check-in. Hold the mouse cursor over an option in the options pane to display a pop-up box with the name, protection scope, and description of the preference being set. A value change is possible only if the protection scope allows it. You can look at a complete description of the preference in the filters, search, and organization panes. On the filters pane, system administrators see 5 tabs and can create preference instances at any preference location. Group administrators can create preference instances at any preference location for their groups, roles, and included users. Non-administrator users see 3 tabs and can create instances for themselves or preferences with a protection scope of user. The filters pane lets you enter text and specify category and protection scope to list preferences in the preferences list box. You can also sort preference instances by name and location. Administrators can use the definition tab to edit a preference definition, or to create a new preference definition, or to create a report of modified user, role, group, or site preferences. The instances tab displays preferences for the site and for your logged in group, role, and user. Users can create and edit their own preference instances for any preference with a protection scope of user. To share preference settings, users can export and import preference XML files. Site and group administrators use the organization pane to add or edit preferences for groups of users and for multiple groups and roles. Those administrators can also use a single command to import preferences for multiple groups, roles, and users through XML preference files. For detailed information about specific preferences, see the preferences and environment variables reference in the Team Center documentation. Preferences tailor the Team Center user interface and functionality to serve your business needs. System preferences apply site-wide. Hierarchical preference protection scope determines who can create and edit preference instances. Administrators add, edit, or delete preference definitions, and create reports for customized preferences. The rich client interface lets users set their own preferences. Users can export and import preferences to share preference settings with other Team Center users.
Team Center Rapid Start is a collaborative PDM system that is easy to deploy and use. With Rapid Start, you can apply reconfigured best practices to everyday engineering tasks and processes. After watching this video, you will be able to describe the purpose of key Rapid Start features, including smart codes, pre-configured workflows, and the shop floor viewer. You will also be able to quickly locate related information about these features in the Team Center online help system. Smart codes enable your company to define a standardized intelligent part number structure that captures important information. For example, you can create a smart code to specify the facility, product family, subclass, and source. With smart codes in place, users simply specify a new design to generate a consistent part number. For information about implementing smart codes, search for configuring smart codes in the Team Center help system. Rapid Start comes pre-configured with the following best-in-class workflows that cover many typical processes. Engineering order. Production release. Obsolescence process. Development release. Status change. Change status to rejected. Change status to review. And change status to released. For more information about pre-configured workflows, search for Rapid Start workflow templates in the help. The Rapid Start Shop Floor Viewer is designed for shop floor use cases, such as machine setup, product assembly, and product inspection. You can use the shop floor viewer to navigate to various scene center objects and functions. For more information about the shop floor viewer, search for help for the shop floor viewer guide. You should now be able to describe several of the features provided by the Scene Center Rapid Start Reconfigured PDM system, including intelligent part numbering, also known as smart codes, preconfigured workflows, and the shop floor viewer.
This video shows how you can use visual reports to identify parts that match a specified criteria. We'll create a visual report that covers the electrical parts red and turns all other parts to be transparent. Let's turn on the 3D visual report toolbar to begin. To start creating the report, click Single Rule Report. From the first list in the report skills section, click Select. Visual reports use metadata saved in the file. Click Execute to search the model for attributes. Now that we have access to the attributes in the model, we'll choose category as the attribute key for the visual report. To complete the query, we must specify a value for the attributes. From the attribute value list, click Select. Just as we have to search the model for attributes, we also need to search for attribute values. Select the parts that you want to search. And then click Regenerate. For this example, we'll choose electrical for the attribute value. The scope of the report is now defined. We'll identify all parts with an attribute called category, set to a value of electrical. For this example, we'll keep the default part appearance settings. To run the report, click Apply. All parts that match the query have become red, unmatched parts have turned semi-transparent.
This video shows how to use collaboration files. When you create a collaboration file, the state of the work session, along with all reference files, is packaged as a single email attachment which you can send to other team members. You must display only the content that you want to include in the collaboration file, such as parts, markups, and groups. You can state the model to focus on a particular design problem. Only visible parts are included in the collaboration file. You can specify to package a lightweight version of the 3D model to reduce the size of the collaboration file. Choose File, Point to Preferences, and then select Collaboration. For 3D content, choose Lightweight. Now let's create the collaboration file and automatically attach it to an email. Choose File, Point to Send Mail, and then select Collaboration File. The contents of the work session are packaged and attached to a new email message. Send the attachment to another member of your team. The recipient simply needs to open the attachment to view the same session. Turn on the model to display the parts in the application. Notice how parts that were not visible at the time the collaboration file was created are not present in the session.
In this example, we'll demonstrate how to relocate parts by referencing the locations of other parts in the model. To begin, select the robot on the left. The robot needs to be aligned with the end of the conveyor. It also needs to be 1,500 millimeters from the conveyor edge. Click Relocate Parts on the 3D Part Information toolbar. In the Relocate dialog box, confirm that part shows the name of the push robot, and from frame expect itself. Notice how the robot's origin now shows a temporary coordinate system. This is the from frame. For the 2 frame, select Pitch feature. Now, on the 3D selection toolbar, click Vertex. In the viewing window, click the top corner of the floor conveyor closest to the robot. A temporary coordinate system appears on the corner of the conveyor. That is the 2 frame. The robot will move in the direction of the yellow arrow. The axes of the 2 temporary coordinate systems may not match. This isn't a problem. For the 2 frame, select Manipulate. In the viewing window, a coordinate system manipulator appears on the 2 frame. Right-click the manipulator and choose Show Position Rotation window. Now click the x-axis of the manipulator, which is red. Change the distance to -1,500. The 2 frame is now 1,500 millimeters from the conveyor. Before applying the transformation, we need to constrain the movement of the robot, which should not rotate or move in the z-direction. Select the Maintain Orientation checkbox. And then select Translate Only On. Followed by X. And Y. Now click Apply to move the robot to its new location in relation to the conveyor. Change the G to confirm that the center of the robot is aligned with the end of the conveyor. And the robot's base is still on the floor. Next, we need to align the other robot with the first robot, 6 meters further along the conveyor. Select the second robot. And click Relocate Parts again. A temporary coordinate system appears at the front frame, which is the origin of the second robot. From the 2 frame list. Select Pitch feature. On the 3D selection toolbar, click Part. Now click the first robot. The left robot now displays the temporary coordinate system. For the 2 frame, select Manipulate. The coordinate system manipulator is placed on the 2 frame. Right-click the manipulator. And choose Show Position Rotation window. Click the manipulator's green y-axis. Now change the distance value to 6,000. The 2 frame is now 6,000 millimeters from the first robot. Before applying the transformation, we need to constrain the movement of the second robot, just as we did earlier before moving the first robot. Select Maintain Orientation. Translate Only On, X, and Y. Now click Apply to move the robot. This video shows how to relocate parts according to the position of other parts. The robots are now both 1,500 millimeters from the edge of the conveyor, and 6 meters from one another. In this example, we'll demonstrate how to create associative measurements, which dynamically update as the parts are moved. To begin, click 3D measurement on the 3D measurement toolbar. Also click double measurement. Now, click vertex on the 3D selection toolbar. To measure the distance between the plates, click 2 points on the model. Now we'll create a second measurement, this time between 2 edges. On the 3D selection toolbar, click edge. And then click 2 edges on the model. Because the plates are parallel, the measurement results are the same. Let's move apart to see how associative measurements work. First turn off the measurement toolbar to stop creating measurements. Now we need to select the part that we want to move. On the 3D part transformation toolbar, click transform parts. In the part information dialog box, confirm that coordinate system is set to global, and the transform mode is set to translate. Click C to move the part along the Z-axis. And then click and drag the slider to move the top plate away from the bottom plate. As the plate moves, the measurements dynamically update. Now click rotate to change the transform mode. Then select the Y-axis. Now click and drag the slider to rotate the top plate. The measurement on the left changes to show the angle between the plates. The other measurement updates to show the changing distance. Your 3D model files must contain the reference CID for you to create associative measurements. You can use Inspector to check whether or not they are in your models. Choose Actions. And then choose Inspector. In the Inspector dialog box, click Execute. On the Results tab, in the Details section, expand the node for the first part. Then open JC Content, Geometry, and XDB Web. The Inspector results confirm that the part contains NVIDIA IDs. In this video, you learn how to create measurements which automatically update as the associated parts are moved. You also learn how to use Inspector to find out if your model contains VREF and NVIDIA IDs, which are required for associative measurements.
Using Team Center, an organization can manage a change through its entire process, from identifying the driver for the change to finding a solution, implementing it, and verifying its incorporation. This video provides an explanation of a typical change management business process to help you understand how your tasks fit into the overall process. It uses an example of a change required to the material of a wheel because it does not stay around under stress. The change driver phase begins with the requester creating an incident report identifying the reason, or driver, for the change. In this case, describing that the wheel is not bound under stress. To aid in the investigation, the requester adds the problem part of any parts that would be impacted by the change. The analyst reviews the incident report, performing tests on the wheel to see how it handles stress, and recommending a halt to production. The change review board looks at the incident report and the work of the analyst. They agree the incident report should be approved and production halted until a long-term solution is determined. The incident report moves to the solution phase, where the requester creates a letter to store the proposed solution, including business justifications and cost estimates. The reference and impacted items from the incident report are automatically added. The analyst then decides that the current wheel material needs to be replaced with one that retains its shape under stress. The analyst adds the wheel material specification to the collector. Because of the severity of the problem with the wheel and the cost of changing production, the change specialist decides this change should follow a formal method, containing reviews and checks. The technical review board evaluates and approves the technical merits of the proposed change solutions and their run cost estimates. The cost estimator develops a more complete estimate of the solution costs. Finally, the change review board evaluates the solution impacts, its priority, and its costs and benefits. It authorizes implementation, and it moves to the change implementation phase, where the requester creates a change implementation collector with the supporting information from the solution collector. Again, the change specialist determines that the implementation phase requires a formal method. The analyst and other engineering departments implement the solution. Adding the new version of the material specification to the change implementation collector, the change specialist sets the date at which the change is effective. The change implementation phase is complete and the incorporation phase begins. The change specialist verifies that the items are released and that the change effectivity was set, and documents any non-conformances. The reviewer verifies that the problem and impacted items were addressed, and that the results passed validation and were released appropriately. The change management business process is finished, and the wheel material was successfully replaced. In summary, a change is managed using four phases. The change driver phase, where the problem is documented and reviewed. The change solution phase, where the solution is determined, reviewed, and approved. The change implementation phase, where the change is applied. The change incorporation phase, where the change is audited and closed.
Using the stock material management functionality in Team Center, you can manage raw material or stocks. This video shows an overview of how a company typically manages its stock material. First, the material manager creates a library of stock materials. By creating a stock material library, you can easily find out the materials you require. Use the Team Center classification application to create the library. Next, the material manager creates the stock materials. After creating the stock, material manager adds it to the library. You can do this by sending the material to the classification application. A program manager specifies that only certain materials can be used in a program. To specify what materials can be used in a program, add the stock material to the preferred items folder of the program. The design engineer selects a part, for example a wind panel, and specifies what stock material the part is made from, along with its dimensions. You can choose what stock the part is made from using the make from command. Using this command, you can pick up the stock from the stock material library. A typical lifecycle of stock management is as follows. Create stock material library. Create stock materials. Associate stock materials to the library. Approve the use of stocks and programs. Specify what stock the part is made from. Welcome to Team Center Active Workspace, your easy-to-use interface to product lifecycle management. You can use a computer, a tablet, or a smartphone to find product data, and participate in business processes. This video is for people who are new to Active Workspace capabilities. Whatever your role, this is your starting point. When you first sign in, you see the home page. You may see a different layout depending on the role. At the top of the screen, you see the home icon, so returning to this page. The themes icon lets you choose the color scheme you prefer. Your username, group, role, and the far-part revision rule are here too. You can select and change the revision rule to display objects with other statuses. If you belong to multiple groups and roles, you can change those also. The page title and previous location arrow are just below the user information. Click or tap your name to edit your user profile or to sign out. The tiles provide quick access to your work. You select the inbox tile to see your workflow tasks. The inbox tile takes you to the inbox page. Here you participate in business processes by performing workflow tasks. When you select a task, relevant information and actions become available. You can easily search in Active Workspace. For example, suppose you need to find a motor electronics assembly. You enter motor as a search term. Here the search results provide a graphic breakdown by type. You can drill down by clicking a column in the chart. You can also narrow searches by filtering, which works like an online shopping site. Select the search filters icon to display the available filters. Select the owner, Dan. Select the motor electronics assembly, and open it.
When you want to know more about a part, you can use the tabs. For example, the word use tab provides the usage information. Command icons are displayed in the toolbar and down the right side of the window. Use the ellipsis more command on the toolbar to display and type command labels. Of course, there are more tab, and command capabilities for you to explore in the future. Do you recall how to sign off from the beginning of the video? If you are thinking by my username, you are correct. In this brief video, you learned about the home page, selecting the tabs in the inbox, and finding and opening the part. Now that you know your way around, you are ready to explore the user assistance, view other videos, and start using Active Workspace. Active Workspace allows you to quickly and easily find the data you need to do your job. In this video, you will learn how to search for objects using text and shape searches, and how to save your searches so you can easily access them with one click. Consider a scenario. The user Ed submits a problem report for a jet engine. The comb assembly needs to be redesigned due to stress issues. To search for the jet engine assembly, that needs redesign, click the search box, and type the text to search. A list of suggestions is displayed. Click search to display the results. Active Workspace displays the number of returned results, a list of the results ordered by their relevance, and the bar chart displaying the distribution of the results by object type. The search includes all data in the properties as well as file contents, such as in a PDF or Word document. To search your searches by type, click the bar to display only the results for that type. The part data is displayed, and the results are categorized by last modifying user. The breadcrumb shows the number of results and the type of data. To select and use search criteria, click the search searches button. Search criteria are displayed, such as the type of data, the owner, and classification information. Click the problem reports for the comb assembly to display more detailed information, such as the summary and affected items. Summary information for the problem report is displayed, such as the description, and grader status. To display the affected items, click the affected items tab. Click the affected comb assembly part for further details. To display any related stress information, click the attachments tab. Click the stress report document to launch Microsoft Word and display the report contents. Type comb in the search box to search for the affected parts. Click search to display the results. Click select type to select the type of data you want to display for the search results. Select the part data type. The part data is displayed for all the comb components and is categorized by owner. Click the owner bar to display all the parts owned by the user Ed. All parts owned by Ed are displayed and categorized by the last modifying user. The breadcrumb at the top of the screen keeps track of the criteria that you selected for the search. Click the search filters button to select and view additional criteria. Select the PDF type. The results are displayed for the PDF and part types. The breadcrumb also indicates there are two types of data displayed for the search results. From the breadcrumb, you can select the type of data you want to filter. To only display the part data, click and remove the PDF filter. Only the part data is displayed, and the breadcrumb is updated. To save the searches, click the Save Search button. In the name box, type the search name. Select the Pinch-On checkbox to display the Save Search on the home page. Click Save. To save searches displayed on the home page, click the tile to run the search. All the parts owned by it are displayed. For further details, click the inner tile part that has stress issues. Click the Shape Search button to find similar parts to the inner tile. A list of similar parts is displayed that might be used for redesigning the comb assembly. To summarize, you can perform text-based and shape searches quickly and easily and display the results in a number of different ways. When displaying search results, the most relevant data is always displayed first. You can easily change search filters to refine searches and to drill down to the data needed. You can save searches so they're accessible with one click.
Hello, and welcome to this presentation on the topic of improving product stewardship and compliance to drive business value. This is Pete Brushy with L&S Research, and it's my pleasure to speak with you today and share some of our research about the increasing importance of product stewardship and manufacturing supply chains. For our agenda, let's start with a brief overview of L&S Research and its ongoing survey of manufacturing organizations, then specifically look at the business context for product stewardship and compliance, as well as the implicit role of technology. Then we'll wrap up with some actual recommendations for how manufacturers can improve product stewardship. L&S is a research and advisory firm headquartered in Cambridge, Massachusetts. It's our mission to drive industrial transformation, and to do that by helping manufacturing organizations achieve operational excellence. We have a team of experienced analysts who are working across the major pillars of operational excellence, that is manufacturing, ESG and sustainability, asset management, and quality management. We use our primary research to identify trends and best practices, and then we make our analyses of our leadership content available through various channels. Since the information of this presentation is in large part based on the L&S Research Environment, Health, and Safety Survey, I'll do a brief overview of that. This is an online survey of ESS business leaders and professionals on a range of sustainability and ESS topics. The survey has had over 300 participants, representing a true cross-section of manufacturing and asset-intensive industries across geographic regions and including different company sizes. Topics covered in the survey include strategic objectives, business challenges, methods, supply chain ESS performance, technology adoption, and many others. Here's an overview of the L&S research model. It's really based on a closed-loop process for continuous performance improvement. The starting point is to establish strategic objectives, to take the organization to the next level, and then to identify the right methods, and to do a comparison with market peers. Then performance gaps are identified, and assess the stage for developing a set of people, process, and technology capabilities that should be implemented to close those gaps. Continuous measurement and monitoring is then applied to drive improvement initiatives. And so, interestingly, this is the overall model L&S applies to operational excellence. You've probably noticed this, it's similar to the Plan, Do, Check, Act model. This is the basis for ESS management system standards, such as ISO 18001 and ISO 14001. Okay, now we look at the business context for product stewardship and compliance and the challenges of implementing effective processes. The key points you'll cover in the rest of the presentation are, first, that manufacturers are under a lot of pressure to properly manage product stewardship and compliance. Much of this pressure is coming from new product compliance regulations, as well as other requirements that are coming from customers and supply chain partners. So this is a new reality where the complexity and volume of information to be managed is only increasing. but many companies are still trying to get by using fragmented processes and siloed systems that increase compliance costs and cause unnecessary risk. In this environment, the smart use of information technology to automate streamlined bar compliance processes is no longer optional, and organizations with significant bar compliance requirements are certainly going to benefit from having a cohesive strategy that's enabled by the right technologies. This is a trend in industrial companies taking an increasingly holistic approach to sustainability. This view encompasses not only the management of EHS compliance and operational risks within the enterprise, but also a wider view of sustainability across the extended supply chain. So this includes energy and carbon management, sustainability performance management, and our most famous for the session, price stewardship. What is price stewardship? Well, one good definition is that price stewardship is the process of minimizing health, safety, environment, and social impacts, and maximizing economic benefits of a product and its packaging throughout all life cycle stages. The key points are minimizing negative impacts of products, maximizing the benefits, and doing so over the entire product life cycle. Price stewardship involves consistently developing and delivering safe, compliant products to the market. For manufacturers, effective price stewardship has then become essential to running a sustainable business. As regulatory requirements and supply chain partner requirements increase, companies are finding that operating sustainably and profitably over the long term depends a lot on incorporating price stewardship into their overall governance and sustainability frameworks. At the basic level, this starts with ensuring compliance and managing